single song. Just without having a rehearsal, we're already dialed in. And just so that it just will make it easier to.
The CD off, compact disc.
Who am I, the Lord of all the earth? Care to know my name, care to feel my hurt. Who am I, that the bright morning star choose to light the way?
It's New Members Sunday, so we welcome and celebrate some of our new members that have gone through the class. We'll see them, and hopefully you guys have, or take home, your new member worship sheet, or no, new member welcoming sheet. We're not worshiping the new members, we're welcoming them. There will be a quiz next Sunday for you to learn the faces, names, and places that they've been, so I won't be here, but you guys get the test. No, I'm kidding. The second announcement I have is next Saturday. We are having our Faith at Work Saturday. We're going to meet at the Mission Campus and go in three different directions. One group will be coming out here, I think, to Neighbors Helping Neighbors. This is volunteers will come together and work on someone's house, projects that people have asked for help in their homes. I will tell you, I will not be at this one because I am next to useless on a work site. So you don't want me there other than comic relief, and I'm not that good. So Neighbors Helping Neighbors, sign up for that one. We're going to be cleaning up Argentine Park with ICOA, another organization, having people go on site, picking up trash, cleaning up the park. And the third one is putting kits together for people with experiencing homelessness. That'll be in the basement, the fellowship hall of the Mission Campus. So there is a QR code in your worship sheet, so check that out on the back. And make note of that. Sign up today or tomorrow so we have an idea of how many people are coming. And I can tell you the Neighbors Helping Neighbors, the handy people, men or women, really need. We're kind of low on that group, so please check that out. There are several other announcements in your worship sheet, but I'll let you look at those later. At this point, I'm going to invite you to please stand and welcome and greet those around you to the house of the Lord. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hallelujah.
We continue with our call to worship and invocation. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new life and hope by raising Jesus from the dead. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We who have received the good news of Christ's resurrection have been sent to proclaim it to those around us. We confess that we have remained silent, content to know the joy of Christ's victory for ourselves, but reluctant to share it. Father, forgive us. Through Christ's death and resurrection, God has triumphed. Your sins are forgiven for Jesus' sake. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we continue to celebrate with joy the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, help us to show the power of his resurrection in all that we say and do. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated for our scripture readings. Actually, our offering first. For those who know, this is our time in our service. We have opportunity to pause and reflect. Give thanks to our God for the many blessings that are in our lives. If you brought your offering with you this morning, you can place it in the container in back, or you can also give online. We continue now with our scripture readings.
The first lesson is from Acts, the fourth chapter. Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of lands or houses sold them, and brought the proceeds of what was sold, and laid it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to each as they had need. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second lesson is from 1 John, the first and second chapters. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of the life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father, and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The children are invited to come forward for the children's message.
Good morning. Come on up, have a seat. Yay. Awesome. How are you this morning? Good? Good? Excellent. Okay, so I'm going to ask you if you guys have ever heard of this Ripley's Believe It or Not. Have you ever heard of Ripley's Believe It or Not? No. Well, see, there was this guy named Mr. Ripley. He liked to gather, like, silly and weird and fun information and wanted people to decide whether they believed it or not. Okay? So this morning, we're going to play a little game. I'm going to read some statements, and you have to decide if you believe me or not. Decide if you believe me or not, if what I'm saying is true. If you think what I say is true, I want you to raise your hands. But if you don't think it's true, then you just leave them down at your side. Okay? Got it? All right. Here's the first one. Okay? In Sweden, bananas are popular on pizza. In Sweden, bananas are popular on pizza. I don't know. It's kind of like I'm not sure. We're not paying attention to him. He played in the first service, so. I'm going to have to give him new questions. Okay, maybe a sort of kind of believe. Nobody else believes me. All right, guess what? It's true. Okay, let's try this one. See if you believe this one. M&Ms were the first candy to go into space. M&Ms were the first candy to go into space. Some of you believe me. Some of you still don't believe me. If you believe me, it's true. It's true. You were right. Okay? Let me give you this one. How about this one? See if you believe this one. The feet of the giraffe are as big as a dinner plate. The feet of a giraffe are as big as a dinner plate. Some of you believe me? Boy, you guys, like the boys, you don't believe me at all. Well, guess what? It's true. Oh, and I have one last one, okay? See if you can get this one. Bumblebees crash into something every 5 seconds. Bumblebees crash into something every 5 seconds. Believe me or not. Kind of the same. Kind of, sort of. Well, it's okay to kind of like sort of not believe that one because that's false. They bump into something every second, okay? Didn't know that, did you? Yeah. So here's the thing. Those were lots of fun statements to decide whether or not you believed me or didn't believe me, right? Okay? Some of you had faith that I was telling you the truth, and some of you did not. Okay? Well, in today's gospel lesson, we're going to hear about someone who didn't believe something right away. Thomas. There you go. Very good. Thomas the disciple. And let me tell you what happened. On that very first Sunday after Jesus had died, okay, and risen again, that very first Sunday evening, the disciples had locked themselves in a room because they were really worried that people were going to come and do to them maybe what they'd done to Jesus because they were followers of Jesus, right? While they were locked in this room, all of a sudden, Jesus appeared. Jesus appeared among them, and the disciples were so excited. They couldn't believe it. He was there. They were so happy. But you see, Thomas happened to not be there that time. So when Thomas gets there, the disciples tell him what happened, and he's like, not unless I see him, not unless I touch him, his hands, his side. I don't believe it. Didn't happen. Okay? Well, it was about a week later, 8 days. And again, they were gathered together in this room. This time, Thomas is with them, and Jesus appears. And Thomas sees him, and he is so excited. And Jesus says, come on, touch me, see that I am real. And Thomas believes this is Jesus. And he says, my Lord and my God, and he falls to his knees to worship him. But this is what Jesus says to Thomas. Because you have seen me, you believed. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. That's talking about faith, right? Because here's my question to you. Have you ever seen Jesus face to face?
Nope.
Oh, there you go. But we know in our hearts and in our minds how much he loves us, right? We know who Jesus is because he has given us his word, okay? He has given us faith through the power of the waters of baptism, and he continues to grow us in that faith, right? Yeah. We can talk to Jesus in prayer. And in Vacation Bible School, we even learn about watching for God, looking for God sightings of where God is at work all around us, because he's at work all around us every day. So even though we can't see him, we believe, right? We have faith. And here's the thing. Do we sometimes have doubts? Yeah, I sometimes have doubts too. But when those times come, okay, God's word and prayer can lead us back to knowing that he's with us. And even through those doubts, he will sustain us and always walk with us. So we have faith. We believe in even the things that we don't see. And what did you say? Will we ever get to see him one day in heaven? Okay, because of Jesus' death and resurrection, we will one day get to live with him forever, and that'll be awesome, okay? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray, but today is also Noisy Collection Day, okay? Because this summer, we're going to do Scuba VBS, and we're going to get a chance to share our faith with other kids, scuba. We're going to dive deep and share our faith with other kids who come, and we are going to watch for God and see where he is at work around us, okay? So let's pray. Okay, ready? Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. Take away our doubt. Grow us in our faith. And let us serve you in all that we do. Amen. All right, grab a bucket. Walk around. People are going to put their change in there. Yeah, you got to come. Somebody's got to come down this side and down the middle aisle.
For these great gifts that you have blessed us with. Help us use these monies to help our Vacation Bible School, to share the great news of Jesus with others in our community and in our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. You can put them over there. I invite you to please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were glad that they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. This morning, I want to take you back to elementary school math class. I know some of your eyes got big. Oh, no. Oh, the horror. And I want to talk about common denominators. Oh, great. I know. So, for a refresher, those who are not in middle school math, a common denominator is a common multiple of the denominators of two or more fractions. So, in simple words, if math can be simple, when the denominator of two or more fractions are the same, then the denominator is known as a common denominator. But for our purposes today, for Pastor Luke oversimplifying things even more so, I'll say it's what do we share in common. In our first reading today, we find ourselves past Jesus' ascension. He's already gone into heaven, and shortly after the day of Pentecost, where the Spirit came among the disciples with tongues of fire on their head as they spoke in many different languages. And after those events, we get this. "Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but that they had everything in common." The common denominator after Pentecost was with a gathering of individuals, of men, women, children, slaves, servants, you name it, the full company of all those who believed. And they gathered together. They prayed together. They worshiped together. They believed in the resurrection together. As evidenced at Pentecost, there were many people who came to believe that day who were from many different nations, many different languages, and many different cultures. And they heard the gospel, the good news of Jesus, in their very native tongue. And they were amazed. Most likely they came from different upbringings, from different social statuses, from a different educational understanding and background. Yet out of that giant melting pot, there was a common denominator. Those who believed were of one heart and soul. They believed. They had faith in the risen Jesus. Their faith is what brought them together. News of the resurrected Jesus Christ touched their hearts and changed their lives as they came to believe in the triune God. They'd given up their false gods. They'd given up their idol worship. They'd given up their ancestral upbringing to believe with one heart and soul. And it had to be challenging to give up what you grew up with, what you were raised in, to push that aside and say, "I'm going to believe in the resurrected Jesus." But that's what united them. That's what brought them together. And in doing so, their individuality comes together like a very small puzzle piece fitting together with a much larger puzzle to make it complete. Puzzles are a great family bonding experience. From my childhood, I can remember my grandmother always having a puzzle set out on her dining room table. She didn't eat at the dining room table. She had a kitchen table to eat at daily. But for the large events, the Thanksgivings and the Christmases, there was the long dining room table in their apartment. And when it came time to eat Thanksgiving dinner, we didn't pack up the puzzle. We didn't put it away for the day. You know what we did? We covered the puzzle. We got a tablecloth across the entire table, and you got to eat on top of the puzzle. Maybe you were lucky enough to feel the puzzle piece underneath. And after eating dinner, we cleaned up, and you know what we did? Pulled the tablecloth back off, and you went and started to pick at that puzzle with Grandma. What a wonderful memory, but also an image of what the church is and can be. A large puzzle with each of us individual puzzle pieces, each one designed with a place to go, with a perfect fit. And once all the pieces are put together in place, we have a wonderful image. The early church was no different. Each person had a designed place to go, a perfect fit, if you will. And all those people, being of one heart and soul, made up a wonderful image of the gathering of believers. With hands joining together, they showed the united church. They showed the fellowship of believers, the hands and feet of God at work in the world around them. The ideal image of the universal church worldwide. And that ideal is also the ideal of our church here at Trinity, both in Shawnee and Mission. Two campuses, yet one united church, united together, walking together as a community following Jesus. And what does a community following Jesus look like biblically? Well, the book of Acts gives us some insight. And he writes, "And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all." In the community in the Bible, there is sharing, community in sharing. If you've ever been around children long enough, you've most likely come across this scene, the opposite of sharing. From toys to food to whatever it is that they want, you've most likely seen this. "It's mine, you can't have it, get away. That's my toy." We don't have to teach our children to be selfish. That's a sinful human nature that's inside them that already knows what it means to say, "Mine, not yours." What we do need to instill them in is how to care, how to love, and how to share. From siblings to classmates to the new person you met at the park playing on the playground, there are many opportunities for our little ones to learn that sharing is caring. It's a life lesson also for us as adults to be reminded of from time to time. For the followers of Jesus in those early days of the church, there was quite a bit of sharing. The apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The apostles, those who had seen the risen Savior, many of whom had been with Jesus at the beginning of his ministry of 3 years, many who had walked with him, who had spent time with him, dined with him, slept in the same building with him, could say and testify to who this Jesus is. They could speak to the scenes and the times that they saw the resurrected Jesus. From Peter and John, running to the tomb, only to find that the tomb was empty, except for the burial cloths that were no longer needed. To Mary's interaction with the gardener, who actually was Jesus, and outside the tomb. To the doubting Thomas of our gospel lesson, who wasn't there when Jesus appears, but was 8 days later and was told to put your hand in my hand, put your hand in my side, stop doubting and believe. and there's Cleopas and an unnamed disciple who walk to Emmaus with Jesus, only to reach the destination, break bread at dinner, to realize that Jesus was with them the whole day, and what do? But run back to Jerusalem, 7 miles at night, to get back with the disciples and say, we have seen and walked with and learned from the risen Savior. The apostles tell these stories, and I'm sure countless others, of the resurrected Jesus. And their testimony goes beyond just that. As they talk about the daily interactions of being with Jesus, as he walked in the countryside with them, healing and teaching, casting out demons and walking on water, and any other numerous miracles. We have just 4 written accounts of Jesus' ministry from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Of which John, as we heard in our gospel lesson, concludes his account this way. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. For the early church, sharing the story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection was a must. It was their opportunity to bring the good news to others. And the story of Jesus' resurrection is still heard here today. As we hear the good news that's been passed on from generation to generation, from pulpit to pulpit to podium standing here before you, passed on through devotions and Bible studies, we hear this good news of Jesus. And the story of his resurrection is shared with you, and it's brought you here today. It's the story that we get to share then with others. We have the opportunity to emulate the disciples and share our stories of Jesus with others. We can share the faith-inspiring moments that we've encountered to celebrate our God's grace in our lives. We can share the depths and the woes of our lives that Jesus walked alongside us and walked us through to encourage others. We can share the salvation and the redemption that has been won through Jesus on the cross for us and for others. Sharing is caring when we share the good news with others. And sharing our story helps point to Jesus. Because the story isn't about me. And the story isn't about you. The story is about Jesus. As our stories, our stories, point our lives to who Jesus is. It points to how we got to where we are today. Our story should point back to Jesus. The blessings of our lives, the joys and the tragedies, the unsolicited grace and mercy that is given by God to us, to each and every one of us, is all through Jesus. A community following Jesus shares the story of Jesus when and where we can. In the early church, our text says, there was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was as distributed to each as any had need. Those who had material blessings were able to share those blessings with others. As blessings multiply blessings, we gather here this morning in the midst of some of those blessings. As we look outside through those doors, or as you walked in, better yet, this morning, and you saw firsthand the construction that's been underway and how quickly and rapidly it's moving, we can see the blessings on display here at the Shawnee campus. We can see our building expanding and our opportunity for outreach into our community is expanding as well. The full number of those who believe were of one heart and soul. and they shared the blessing of their lives with others, to all those who had need. We have the opportunity to do the same, to share our blessings with those who have need. We have seen the blessings in our lives, and in turn, we can have them be a blessing to others. We can see how God blesses us in our lives in fulfilling our daily needs. And we pray for those daily needs every time we pray in the Lord's Prayer, "Give us this day our daily bread." We aren't praying literally for bread, for a slice of bread today. "Dear God, please give me a slice of bread." No, we're praying for our daily needs, bread and beyond. And let me emphasize that word, the needs, our daily needs, because there's a big difference between a need and a want. I may want a sports car, but I don't need a sports car. I may want this "I'm not needy, I'm wanty" t-shirt, but I don't need this t-shirt. A want is a child's birthday or Christmas wish list. A need is making sure that child has food and clothing. Our wants and our needs need to be properly assessed. And the early church did a great job of that. They took care of the needs of the community. They supported each other and were united in their shared belief in the resurrected Jesus Christ. We too are united in our shared belief in the resurrected Jesus Christ. For we are a community following Jesus that gathers together, that shares and cares for the needs of others. And it does its best to fulfill those needs when they're made known. We come from different upbringings, from different social statuses, from different states. I'm an Illinois boy, if you will, and even different countries and regions. But our common denominator is this: we all believe in the resurrected one, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. Now may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to please stand at this time as we have opportunity to confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." We sing our song of the day, Instrument.
Just a flicker in the flame.
break the veil of night. To the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, three in one. I offer you myself, though I'm broken and spent. Let me be your
Please be seated. At this time, I'll invite all the new members of our congregation to come forward. We'll spread out this way so we're not all left justified, right justified. Dear friends in Christ, we rejoice to have you join us as the people of God gathered here in this place. In Matthew 10, Jesus tells us to acknowledge him before people with the promise that he will acknowledge us before his Father in heaven, that we may rejoice in your confession. I now ask you in the presence of God and of this congregation, do you believe in God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, answer, yes, I believe. Yes, I believe. Do you believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God and the teaching of the Lutheran Church is a faithful and true understanding of that word of God? If so, answer, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
Will you remain faithful to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and suffer all rather than denying him? If so, answer, I will by the grace of God. I will by the grace of God. As disciples, as those who seek to follow Jesus, we seek to conform ourselves to the image of Christ. We hold ourselves to a standard of behavior that we do not expect of non-Christians. And so I ask you, do you intend to live your life according to his word to the best of your ability? When you fall into sin, as we all do, will you acknowledge that sin and turn back to God to receive his forgiveness and grace? If so, answer, I will with the help of God. Our calling as a congregation is to be a community following Jesus, who care for and serve all those around us with the love of Christ. As a congregation, we would continue to love and care for and serve you, even if you didn't join. But when you join this congregation, you commit yourself to joining with us in this work. And so I ask you, will you join with us as a community following Jesus? Will you support the work of this congregation with your prayers, your time, your talent, and your treasure? If so, answer, I will with the help of God. Upon this, your confession of faith, I welcome you as members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the mouth to confess his saving name. Join them with us in the one great body of Christ, as together we serve others in your name and await the day of your glorious return. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, and here's the challenging part that I have as I get to meet you and greet you for the very first time. So, the Bailey family, welcome. 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 The days. Welcome, Jason.
And Jason's
back there. He's camera shy. Lamping. Welcome.
Thank you.
And Connie, welcome. And Marie, welcome. Please show a round of applause for our new members. You guys want to turn? You guys can go back to your seats. I invite the rest of you to please stand as we continue with our prayer of the church. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, your Son is the firstborn from the dead. In him we have been reborn into a new and living hope. Nurture us with the pure milk of your word that we may grow to maturity of faith and have everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all those who mourn the death of loved ones. We pray especially today for Donna Wilson and family upon the death of Donna's brother-in-law, Bill. We also lift up the friends and family of Colin Cottis, a friend of Beth Stevens, upon his unexpected death. Comfort those who mourn with your gospel promise that all who die in Christ live forever with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, as your people are united in the common life and love of our Savior, grant that we would share that life and love with those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, build up the households of your people, that your holy children, begotten in baptism, may grow in your grace and share together in your forgiveness and life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have instituted authorities to carry out your justice. Bless all who make, administer, and judge the laws of our land. Give them wisdom, integrity, and honor to serve according to your goodwill. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As your Son's wounds brought gladness and peace to the troubled disciples, give your presence and comfort to those troubled in our midst. Lord, we pray for Don MacArthur, Howard Nellis, Shelley Archer, Kathy Dobbins, Carter Neese, as well as those we name in our hearts before you now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we give thanks for the successful medical procedures underwent by Justin Schmidt, Richard Wynn, and Jamie Peck in this last week or so. We pray for continued healing and strength for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for your goodness in our lives. We rejoice with all those who celebrate birthdays, anniversaries, and other life milestones. We especially rejoice with Dan and Susie Schramm as they celebrate their 50th wedding anniversary this week. Give us thankful hearts that acknowledge your blessings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray all of these things in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. The same way also he took the cup after supper. When he given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is my cup of the New Testament, to shed for you for the remission of all your sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Taught by our Lord, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. This morning there will be a small tray of gluten-free wafers that will be on this side in, on the chairs in front. So if you're sitting on this side and desire to have gluten-free wafers, I encourage you to make your way over to this side. If you're a baptized child of God and believe this to be the true body and blood of Jesus Christ, given for you for the forgiveness of your sins, then I invite you to come forward to taste and see what our Lord has done, for the table of the Lord is ready. Welcome to the Lord's table. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed on the cross for the remission of all your sin. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed on the cross for the remission of all your sin. Depart in his joy and peace. Amen.
It is well.
bless you and keep you as you continue to grow in your faith.
Now, with the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in his joy and peace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us to the healing power of this gift of life. We pray that in your mercy, you'd strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you to please stand as we sing together our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Receive now the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. Before we go to our closing song, though, Brandon, I'm going to invite all of the eighth graders that are here with us this morning to meet Rhonda in the back. There's a special surprise for you. So eighth graders, please head to the back of the sanctuary at this time. Eighth graders, all eighth graders, your parents are aware. Don't worry.
Eva will join you at the end of this song.
Fantastic. We sing our closing song, You Are I Am. Thank you. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.